We learned from pirates that X marks the spot. But when it comes to DNA, does X really help us any? Howdy, I'm Andy Lee with Family History Fanatics, and this is a segment of DNA. Today, I wanted to talk about the X chromosome and how we could use the X chromosome to help us in our research and what limitations it actually has. So there are five principles that I want you to remember about XDNA, and I'm going to go over them today. So principle number one is our inheritance patterns are different. How males and females get their XDNA is going to be different. So let's take a look at how males and females inherit their XDNA. So for males, we have an X chromosome and a Y chromosome. We get the Y chromosome from our father, which means we get the X chromosome from our mother. So if you start right here, you can see that all of the XDNA is coming from the mother's side. And every time there is a male in the lineage, so with your grandfather, your great-grandfather, that also is going to eliminate some of those people that you could have received DNA from, because you don't. So XDNA from the male side, 100% of it comes from the mother, which means that 50% of it comes from each grandparent on average. And then as you go the next generation back, one side has 50% coming from the grandmother and the other side has 25% coming from each grandparent. And this pattern continues on throughout the different generations. So with females, they have two X chromosomes. They receive one X chromosome from their father and one X chromosome from their mother. And so this starts out very similar to autosomal DNA, where you would expect 50% from the father, 50% from the mother. But as you go back in each generation beyond that, just like with males, you start to eliminate any chance of receiving DNA from the male line. So for instance, the father of a daughter only got his XDNA from his mother. So that paternal line no longer has any XDNA being contributed to that granddaughter. Likewise, on the mother's side, this pattern is the same as what we saw on the male side. So each one, males and females, receives slightly different inheritance of XDNA. And that's important when we're looking at any matches that involve XDNA. So principle number two, because we're only looking at one chromosome, we don't actually follow this 50% inheritance exactly. Now with females, they do inherit 50% of their XDNA from their father and 50% from their mother because they receive a full chromosome from their father and a full chromosome from their mother. They also receive that same full chromosome from their paternal grandmother. Now beyond that, the amount of XDNA that you receive from any great-grandparent or great-great-grandparent is really dependent on recombination. And that is a random process that may give you large chunks or small chunks. It may give you three or four segments, or it may just give you one segment. So you can't use a table of percentages to estimate back how many generations you are, because your lines follow different ways and you're only dealing with one chromosome. So there's not enough to keep that 50% overall. Now, over a whole population, on average, yeah, it's going to follow that 50% ratio. But on an individual basis, we're just dealing with one chromosome here, so we can't use that assumption. So principle number three is, if you have an XDNA match without any autosomal DNA match, that match is probably distant enough that you're not going to be able to determine how you're related. So when you're looking at XDNA, make sure you're focusing on those that you also share some autosomal DNA with. Now the fourth principle is XDNA is an excellent elimination tool. It tells you who you don't need to go and look at. As you saw from the inheritance patterns, every male in the line takes away the XDNA from before them for males. And that can eliminate a lot of your tree. So if you do have a match on autosomal DNA that you also have an XDNA match, if you are male or if you are female, the number of ancestors you actually have to look at is different. Let's use a couple of examples. So if we are four generations back, so your parents, your grandparents, your great-grandparents, your great-great-grandparents, this would be third cousins. You have 16 great-great-grandparents. And so with an autosomal match, you might have to look through 16 different lines to try to figure out which one is who you are related through. However, if you're male, because of all the people that you can eliminate that you didn't inherit any XDNA from, you only have to look at 5 lines. And if you're female, you still get a benefit because you only have to look at 8 lines. So you only have to look at a third to half of all the possibilities with an XDNA match. And that's at 4 generations. It gets better the further back you go. Now looking at 6 generations, this is about the extent of where autosomal DNA, genealogical DNA testing is going to provide a good solid match to. You have 64, and this would be your 4th great grandparents, so your 5th cousins, which is pretty distant. You have 64 4th great grandparents that normally on autosomal DNA, you'd have to figure out which one is where you're related to. But with that XDNA match, if you're male, you only have 13, less than a quarter of the total 4th great grandparents that you have to look at because you've eliminated all the others. And if you're female, you still get a good benefit, only 21, less than a third of all of the potential 4th great grandparents that you have to look at to find how that relationship is. So XDNA is an excellent elimination tool. Now the 5th principle is something I've actually talked about through this whole thing, and that is you have to understand the difference between males and females when it comes to XDNA matching and who you could possibly match up with. Because that inheritance pattern is different, if you have a match and you're female and that XDNA matches with a male, then you're using two different inheritance patterns when you're looking at your two trees. And you gotta remember to keep that separate so that you can eliminate the most possible people and also be able to find matches that you have autosomal matches with as well using your XDNA. So if you have any questions about how you can use XDNA in your genetic research, put it in the comments below and we'll try to help you out. If you like this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up so that it can reach more viewers. Be sure to check out our website, www.familyhistoryfanatics.com, so that you can find out about upcoming e-conferences that we're going to be a part of.